everyone, and welcome. I'm excited today to talk to you about making data connectivity as easy as possible with our brand new no-code connector platform. My name is Keshia Rose. I'm a senior product manager here at Algolia. I've been working in data for about 10 years, and me and my team here at Algolia focus on making it as easy as possible to bring data into the Algolia platform. In the next 20 minutes or so, we're going to go over what data connectivity means at Algolia. We're going to talk about our connectivity strategy and our approach. And then I'm going to show you some of the cool new features and capabilities we've been adding to our ever-growing no-code connector platform. Now, what exactly do I mean by data connectivity? So let's start there and first define that. What I'm talking about is bringing data wherever it may live, whether that may be an e-commerce platform, a content management system, database, a flat file, wherever you've got your data that you want to search, bringing that data into Algolia. Now, doing that is probably the first step in any implementation. It's one of the base building blocks, and anything you do starts there and builds on top of it. Now, I'm talking about data. I don't just mean maybe your catalog data. I'm not just talking about your movies that you want to search or your product inventory or articles. I'm also talking about interactivity data. So what exactly are your users doing when they search? What's popular? What's trending? Being able to get that data and information as well and use that to collect feedback on your search experiences will help you to fine-tune your relevance and build even better search experiences overall. So whether we're talking about record data or event data, all of the above is important to get into Algolia so you can build those experiences and do it super easily. So that's our main focus for our connectivity strategy. First, we want to simplify the data ingestion process. We want to remove steps from your plate wherever we possibly can, making it as easy and smooth as possible. We also want to allow to connect to multiple data sources because we know that data can live in a various amount of places. We want to remove the needs for you to build out new infrastructure and new data processes, and we want to handle data freshness for you. Let us worry about making sure your data is synced and accurate. Overall, we want to make it easy for anyone and everyone, no matter how comfortable you are with coding. For our non-technical users, we've got a brand new beautiful UI that allows you to manage your connectors. And for our developers, all of our tools are built on APIs that allow you to integrate them with your implementation and making it easy to remove some of those steps. So let's take a look at what we did last year at DevCon 2022. Now here we had shown just the very beginnings of our new no-code connector platform. We showcased the three main building blocks: source, which allows you to define how to access your data and let us know where it is; the destination, where in Algolia do you want to put that data; and the task, that brought the source and the destination together and told us exactly how to process and handle that data. Now, I only showed APIs last year. We only had the CSV file connector. It really was the very basics of our platform, but we have grown so much since then, and I'm really excited to show you what we've added. First up, probably the biggest addition, is our brand new connector hub. This is where you're going to find all of these connectors. Let's jump in and take a look. Here we have our brand new list of native Algolia connectors. And as you can already see, we've expanded from just the CSV connector. We now have JSON, commerce tools, and as of today, a brand new beta Google BigQuery connector as well. Now you can find this page by going to the Data Sources tab down here in the bottom left in the dashboard, and then selecting connectors. Now, we're going to be showcasing our no-code connectors here, but this connectors page is really meant to be a place where you can find all of the ways to connect to data. So keep an eye on it as we continue to grow, because we'll continue to add more methods here. Now, if I scroll down, you can see a couple more things like our external applications. For example, we've got a big commerce connector coming up soon, and these live within external party, third-party dashboards. So for example, we've got the Shopify plugin or our Salesforce Commerce Cloud cartridge. Those all live here as well. We also showcase some of the partner integrations for data connectivity here as well. And if you can find more, if you want to, in the Code Exchange website too. Now, if you don't see what you're looking for here, or if you want us to add a new connector, let us know. We've got an option right here on the connectors page where you can type in the data source that you want us to build a connector for, and we'll take a look at it and help us to prioritize which connectors we build next. All right, so let's go back. So again, started here last year at DevCon 2022, and now we've already started by building out an actual hub to hold these connectors along with any other ingestion methods. And you can see already, we're really starting to expand our list of connectors. Now, the next thing we wanted to do was make it even easier to set up your data source. So let's go back to the dashboard, and let's take a look at that CSV connector that we had built last year. We've got a couple new features here that I want to show you. Now, as you're defining this data source, you'll go through and give us information about maybe if it's protected or not, where to find that CSV, you know, what kind of method to use. But you'll see this brand new button here, this little lightning icon. Whenever you see the lightning icon, that lets you know that we're giving you a little auto-magical button to help you set your data source up. So when we're thinking about CSV files, when that data gets brought in, it's brought in all as text. So even if you have numbers, for example, doesn't matter, CSV is going to bring everything in as text, and you need to change each column to its appropriate data type so you can use it well when you're configuring your search relevance. Now, originally, you had to go through and manually say each column and their data type. We're adding a little bit of automagical help here to get that going for you. So here you can see if I hit this little type mapping button, I can go to a sample of my CSV file. I'm going to copy just a couple of these rows and paste that in. And then we can go and click on infer type mapping. Here you can see we've got each column from my CSV, and we automatically infer the data type. So it's an integer or a string or a float, etc. Now you have full control. You can always change these to be a different data type if you like. We're just hoping to make that a little bit easier for you. And we've added things like this, these little lightning buttons around to different sources, depending on what's necessary for each configuration. All right. So we've gone ahead and talked about some of those new easy configuration tools, and we've also added some more capabilities to our destinations and especially tasks as well. But to show you those, I'm going to build out a full connector from start to finish so you can see how everything comes together. Let's head back to the dashboard. See how everything comes together. Let's head back to the dashboard. Okay. So here we've got the connectors page. This time I'm going to use our brand new Google BigQuery connector that's currently in beta. Let's take a look and get started. Now the first thing you need is to set up your Google service account. So here you can go ahead and add in a new account. You can either drag and drop the JSON file with the credentials, or you can manually enter the client email and the private key. I've already done this beforehand, and I can go ahead and select this Google service account that I've already entered. Next, we need some information about the table itself, like the project ID, dataset ID, and the name of the table. So let me go ahead and enter that now. So I've got our project ID. Then we've got the dataset ID. Make sure I spell that correctly. Connector, there we go, US. The name of our table is products. And then this next piece here is very important. What we're looking for is a unique property identifier, or which column uniquely identifies each and every row in your table. In our case, that's ID. For you, it might be SKU or username or something like that along those lines. Either way, that is going to be used as the object ID in your index in Algolia. Next, if I wanted to, I could add some custom SQL here, but I'm going to skip that for now. And then the last option here is to add a name for this source. We built this connector platform to be really composable, so you can kind of mix and match different sources and destinations. So it's important to name it something that you'll recognize later on. I'm going to go ahead and just leave it with the auto-generated name here and create my source. Okay, next I'm going to create a new destination. In this case, I'm going to create a brand new index. Let's call it Cool Products. Go ahead and hit Use Cool Products. And aha, we have another one of those little lightning bolt icons. And in this case, we need credentials to use when ingesting that data and putting it into your index. And instead of making you go back to the API settings page and trying to figure out how to make a new key with the right scopes, you can just hit this button and say, create one for me. And we'll do it for you. All set. Don't have to worry about it. Again, here I'm going to keep the automatically generated name. This is perfectly fine. And create my destination. Now here's where we've added a couple of new things. So there's two pieces that you need to configure when putting your source and destination together with a task. The first is how we should fetch that data. Should we do it on demand? Should it be scheduled? Or should we do it based on some certain event? So we have added a couple new different methods here. The on-demand, of course, is you saying, run this task right now when I push this button or when I send out this API request. The scheduled one, you can set a specific frequency, and every interval of that frequency will go out and fetch that data. And then where available, we also offer a subscription method. So for example, if you're using our Commerce Tools connector, you can have a subscription task that updates your data every time a product changes in your catalog, maybe a category name changes. It'll listen for those updates and automatically do the updates to your index. The second piece is what we should do with the data once we have it. Originally, we only had replace. We've since added a new option called save. Replace, of course, will replace your entire index in its entirety, whereas save is more like an upsert. If we find the object already, we'll update that information. If it doesn't exist, we'll add that as a new object. For today's demo, I'm going to go ahead and do a scheduled task. Now, you can go ahead and add your own cron expression here, but we also offer some really easy, simple, intervals for you automatically out the box. So I'm going to say every day, I'm going to keep replace and create my task. Now, I'm going to go ahead and run this task right now. So go ahead and run. Now, this task is scheduled, as we can see here, the frequency is daily, and it will run once every day on its own, but I have more to show you with the tasks and how they run, so I'm going to run it right now and get that going. Okay, just to recap, let's go back. We've talked about how we added some new ingestion methods. We only had replace before. We now have append or save as well. And we also have some refresh options, so we now have the event-triggered or subscription-based options there too. Now going back to our connector here, at this moment, that connector is reaching out to Google BigQuery. It's using the information I provided to access the data in the table. It's bringing that information back in as JSON and adding it to a newly created index. So let's see if it's done by taking a look at our indices. All right, there we go. Perfect. We can see we've got Cool Products. Last build was a few seconds ago, and we have just under 1,000 records. Let's hop in and take a look. Awesome. We can see all of our data is here. We've got all the different information. And from here, you can continue to go through and configure your index to build up the best search experience for you. All right, so the last thing I wanted to show you is around observability. So if I go back to our connectors page here, you can see we've got a couple tabs here where you can go through and look at the individual pieces, so the sources, the destinations, and the tasks. But we also have this connector debugger. Now, this is an amazing new tool we've just added recently, which I'm very excited about because it really allows you to see exactly what's going on when you're using our new no-code connectors. Whenever you run a task, whether that's from a subscription update or you push the button or the schedule interval, occurred and we ran it for you automatically, every single time a task gets run, that run will show up here. So we can see we've got that BigQuery connector that I just ran, we can see that the outcome was successful and that it's done, it's finished. If I click on it, I can see some more of the details about the timing, what happened, and I also get each step of the journey. I can see here that it started with our BigQuery connector and it went to our cool products index. And if I go back to the events here, these are pretty basic for this particular example, but we can see as we go through, if you had more events, if you had an error, all of that information would happen here. We also provide some tools that help you find what you're looking for. So you can see you've got some different sorting and searching options. And if you want to, you can filter based on the type or the status. So for example, if you want to see only failed or retried events here, you could find those easily. In general, we're making it super easy for you to understand what's happening, because if we're doing it for you, we want to let you know what's going on under the hood. All right. So bringing that back, we've got our brand new observability tools with our debugger. And as you can see, we've really expanded on the platform that we showcased last year, and we're going to continue to expand on it as well. Because overall, we want to make it as easy as possible for anyone and everyone. Like I said, whether you're a non-technical user, whether you're a developer or somewhere in between, we want to make it easy for anyone to get going with their Algolia journey. Everything I showed you here today is available in that great UI, or that user interface that I showcased in the demo, but every single step, every button I pushed, every capability is also backed up and based on APIs first as well. So however you want to interact, whether it's through code, or using API requests, or using the user interface, it's there for you and available. Now, speaking of available, all of this is freely available. So if you have an Algolia account, you can use these connectors for free to get going with your own data ingestion. Now, before we go, I would love to hear from you. We want to know, what kind of data sources do you want to connect to? Because we're going to continue to build out our connector hub with brand new connectors, and we're really curious to hear some feedback. So I'd love to hear from you. If you can take a little time and go to alg.li/connector feedback and let us know. What kind of data sources do you want to connect to? I'm also curious to hear what kind of data transformations you like to do as well. All in all, I hope that you are just as excited as I am about our brand new no-code connector and how we're continuing to expand on it. Thank you so much for your time today, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.